In April of 2020, in the midst of the COVID-19 pandemic, the CDC made an official recommendation. Non-medical personnel should wear masks. That recommendation came from lessons learned during pandemics of yesteryear. The CDC knew that even simple masks on the faces of many could slow the spread of disease. That also made sure that the more powerful protective equipment like the now famous N95 respirator would be reserved for healthcare workers on the front lines of the pandemic. That's great, but this practice is alarmingly recent. Infectious disease doctors didn't don respirators until 25 years before COVID-19 landed. Why did it take so long to protect our healthcare workers? And how did we get to this when we started with this? To figure out why masks are important, we first had to figure out why germs were important and how we spread them. Starting in the Middle Ages, doctors and scientists believed in something called the miasma theory of disease. Rotten, deadly air, or miasmas, caused disease. After all, those dead bodies had a similar repulsive smell, so that smell must have killed them. The plague doctor didn't wear his mask to prevent infection, but to keep their air smelling nice and miasma-free. This idea held strong until the mid-1800s, when scientists put forward a new model of disease called germ theory, which lines up more nicely with what we believe today. Germs cause disease, and specific germs cause specific diseases. Tuberculosis came from Mycobacterium tuberculosis, cholera from Vibrio cholerae. These are different bacteria, and they cause different diseases. Germ theory was a huge deal in the history of medicine. Disease might have been microscopic, but it was no longer invisible. This was one of the factors that kicked off, for the time, revolutionary practices like cleaning your surgical instruments, or using antiseptics, or washing your hands. More on that one in a future video. We had noticed before that when one of the patients in the hospital had a disease, the nurses and doctors, and often the other patients, tended to get the same disease. But now we knew how. It made sense that physical touch could transmit disease, but people were still getting sick even without direct contact. Take tuberculosis, an incredibly common respiratory disease back then. We knew we could get sick from people with TB, but the details were sketchy. Some hypothesized that the bacteria might have been concentrated around sick people, but not excreted by sick people. German scientist Carl Fluge cleared things up in 1897 when he found that tuberculosis bacteria showed up on droplets of saliva from sick people and in plentiful numbers, more than enough to get someone sick. You didn't need direct contact with a sick person after all. Getting coughed on or even just having a conversation with a sick person was enough to land you their disease. These days, we call those microscopic spit particles respiratory droplets. Fluge recommended doctors start wearing surgical masks to keep them from spewing respiratory droplets. The point was to prevent surgeons from spreading disease to their patients, not the other way around. A few years later, a woman named Alice Hamilton backed up that recommendation with an experiment of her own. She went into different operating rooms and recorded how often surgeons talked. And it was a lot. They constantly opened their mouths, breathing all kinds of bacteria, mostly strep and staph, onto their patients' open abdomens. Surgeons would need to wear masks to protect the patient from the surgeon. More lab-based research would come out later, but doctors had the opportunity to test the mask concept in 1910 when a plague broke out in northern China. What started in a small town on the Russian border spread eastward, killing tens of thousands of people with a near 100% fatality rate. But how did it spread? Some thought through rats or fleas, while Dr. Wu Liente, a Chinese doctor, thought that Fluge's respiratory droplet idea might work here. So they used masks. Masks on themselves and masks on the patients. And these were far from modern masks. They were mostly rolls of gauze wrapped around the mouth and nose. They weren't the best defense, but it was something, and it was well documented. The black and white photos that made it into newspapers made these masks look really cool, which is part of what made them popular. This is a total side note, but there was this racist French doctor who hated that a Chinese doctor was right. So out of spite, he visited a sick ward without wearing a mask to prove that he was right, and He died 2 days later. So with this successful trial in China, a bigger wave of research came in the 1910s. There were a handful of experiments, but two main takeaways. The first was that if you put masks on the patients and or hospital staff, then you cut down on disease. Not down to zero, but down nonetheless. The second was that not all masks work the same. Here's how we figured that out. A pair of scientists had people gargle with a bacterial wash and cough through different mask materials onto agar plates. After letting the bacteria grow, they found the bacteria could easily get through 10 layers of gauze, but not through 3 layers of buttercloth, a fabric with a tighter mesh than gauze. So at this point, masks seem like they work, and we're starting to learn best practices for wearing them. Unfortunately, our knowledge of masks was probably too young and too immature when one of the largest pandemics in history hit in 1918. So for context, World War I was on its final stretch. It was already a huge loss of life, partly because of chemical warfare. And while chemistry is a powerful weapon, biology would prove much deadlier. Chemical warfare killed 90,000 people, but the flu pandemic of 1918 killed 50 million people. The United States accounted for 675,000 of those deaths, and in San Francisco alone, a city of 100,000, the influenza virus affected 45,000 people and killed 3,000. And that was with masks. People saw their mask wearing as a way to support the troops still fighting in Europe, so masks were worn broadly and proudly. In theory, this should have been more effective than it was. We knew that the influenza virus could spread through respiratory droplets, so a mandatory mask law seemed like a good idea. But in practice, the physical masks themselves were the problem. They either weren't thick enough to filter anything, and if they were thick enough, they were also hard to breathe. Plus, there was no instruction on how these masks should fit, so respiratory droplets spilled out everywhere. Eventually, the pandemic passed, and the scientific community narrowed in on why their ad hoc, loose-fitting gauze masks were so bad. In 1930, a study was published that recommended some kind of minimum standard for masks, which included the nose crimp. The tighter the seal, the less chance there is for the virus to spread. Now, during the 1918 pandemic, healthcare workers actually fared relatively well. Not because they were taking extra precautions, they weren't. They were woefully underprotected. They fought on the front lines of the pandemic and stuffed between sick patients in close quarters. If you were a doctor working back then, your survival was influenced by a few different factors, like your age or where you worked, and whether it was a civilian or a military hospital. But immediately after the pandemic, nobody from the government really saw the situation with the healthcare workers as an emergency. On the other hand, after the world warred and babies boomed, the American economy had swaths of new workers available. All of a sudden, the government realized it was a good economic decision to protect them. So in 1970, the US federal government founded OSHA, the Occupational Safety and Health Administration, so that they could keep their workers safe and contributing to the economy, which is really what we're getting at here. OSHA is known for creating hilarious standards for standing on ladders, but also recommendations for masks. We already had surgical masks to keep society safe from what you breathed out, but now OSHA was looking for a type of mask that would keep workers safe from what they breathed in, whether that was the coal dust that blackened lungs or that sweet, sweet asbestos. Now, asbestos is bad, but it's not contagious, so surgical masks were useless here. This is when respirators took off, including the N95 respirator, which has become a household name these days. The American brand 3M repurposed some materials and came up with a loose mesh design that let fresh air flow in and out, while the fibers themselves had an electrostatic charge that would zap pathogens to the fibers. Along with these new masks came new lessons in donning and doffing, as well as fit tests to make sure that the mask fits snug on your face. And that's great for industrial workers, but updates for healthcare workers wouldn't come until the 1990s. That was because tuberculosis was starting to show a weird pattern in the United States. By 1984, infections came down to a quarter of what they were in the 50s. But the graph started sloping upwards as we approached the 90s. Part of that was because we were in the middle of the AIDS epidemic, which compromised a lot of immune systems, but also because of new, drug-resistant forms of the bacteria that caused tuberculosis. While the report laid out a drug treatment, it also made one thing clear: wear better masks. Those N95s seem to be working in the industrial sector. Use those. We heard the same message after the bioterrorism fears around 9/11, the SARS outbreak in 2003, H1N1 in 2009, and Ebola in 2014. Wear protective equipment, make sure it fits, and take the protection of our healthcare workers seriously. Now, things can change a bit during a pandemic. We've seen hospitals run out of personal protective equipment before, probably in your lifetime even. It happened in American hospitals during the SARS and H1N1 outbreaks. The CDC made that recommendation because they've learned this lesson before. We wear cloth masks in addition to social distancing, good hygiene, and all the other best practices as part of lowering the curve, but also to make sure the capacity of the healthcare system stays as high as it can. Keeping our hospital staff safe is one of the most important and impactful things that you and I can do. It's taken us decades to learn these lessons from history. We don't need another lesson. We need to work together.